Forcepoint, your people are the best defense for your company's critical data and IP. The evolution of cybersecurity has brought us to a new place. Beyond anti-malware solutions, network access control, patch management, past IDS, IPS, biometric authentication, and 128-bit secure routers, to here, to the critical...
Welcome to Forcepoint's Human Point Security. Firstly, I'd like to warmly thank you, all of you, because I know it's been a rough day in terms of weather. And while I was coming here, I was just reading up the news. May in Kolkata this year has been the coldest in the last 10 years because it's been raining. So it's a very pleasant change for people like us who've come from Bombay and Delhi. So thank you so much for making it here. My name is Harshal Doshi. I'm a strategic solutions consultant at Forcepoint India. And over the course of the next couple of hours, we have a very interesting lineup of events. I'm sure you're going to have a lot of content coming your way. So a little bit about Forcepoint before we actually begin the event for the day. I'm sure all of you know us as WebSense over the last 20 years that we've been in the industry now. WebSense has been a global leader in web and email security along with data for quite a long time. In 2015, in the end of 2015, we got acquired by a company called Raytheon. Raytheon happens to be one of the world's largest defense contractors, which actually makes us a part of a family which is more than $40 billion strong. The cybersecurity arm of Raytheon hence actually got renamed as Forcepoint. Now, once we got renamed as Forcepoint, we've been actually on the journey of redefining cybersecurity. I'm sure all of you who are custodians of cybersecurity have been in this industry for a very long time, and you've heard a lot of vendors speaking about, you know, how they are approaching cybersecurity. What is different about Forcepoint is that we've actually relooked at the entire threat landscape which has been evolving over the last decade or so. And what we realized is that we are missing a very critical factor which is contributing to cyber threats. Any guesses what that is? I'm sure the video kind of gave you that hint. It is us, humans. And while we were actually doing this kind of rethinking about cybersecurity, we realized that understanding human behavior, understanding human intent, was a very critical aspect in tackling cybersecurity threats. And one of the reasons for that is when we analyzed every cybersecurity attack which happened globally, whether it had impact on financial institutions, whether it had impact on countries, governments, or even individuals like us, what we realized is that more than the threat being from outside, it was actually the insider who was responsible for that particular threat being executed. And that actually kind of rang our bells and forced us to rethink as to how enterprises like yours should actually address cybersecurity threats. Should we start looking inside? Now, with this particular base of thought, we actually started acquiring a lot of technologies for the last couple of years. We have acquired a series of behavioral analytics technologies, which actually forms the heart of the human point system, which we are going to speak about in a while. We've also kind of caught up with the trends which are in the market right now. I'm sure most of you are adopting cloud, mobility, so on and so forth. And we realize that that's the future. And, taking security to that particular next level is also very important. And hence we acquired a CASB solution, which actually gives you unprecedented visibility on your cloud applications. Also, what we understand is that advanced threats actually have become so evasive that it requires a completely new way of addressing those threats from a network perspective. And hence, we acquired a next generation firewall technology from Stonesoft. And after actually bringing all of these pieces together, what we have done is that we've created a very beautiful structure called the human-centric security or the human point security. What it helps you do is that a combination of all of these technologies will actually help your cybersecurity posture from currently reactive to predictive. Wouldn't that be an ideal situation? And secondly, the human point system also allows you to have a single pane of glass from a risk perspective. Currently, we are looking at cybersecurity from a very threat and incident perspective. We are actually changing that paradigm and giving you a very human-centric view of it. And thirdly, we are actually building a platform which will help you automate response. To actually elaborate all that, we have a series of sessions coming your way. But before we get started, we have a very eminent panel of speakers lined up today. So the first speaker that we have today is a CEO of an organization called ISOAH, which is the Indian School of Anti-Hacking. I'd like to call on stage Mr. Sandeep Sengupta. He is the CEO of ICOAH. I'd like you all to welcome him with a big round of applause. Thank you so much, Sandeep, for making it, and over to you.
Thank you very much. This is working?
Hello. A very good evening to all of you over here. A lot of known faces again. 50% I already know. It seems like most of the events, they want an ethical hacker to scare people. So, well, I am the ethical hacker. I am a ISO 27001 lead auditor. I work very closely with the Lal Bazar police and the CID. So what I am trying to share with you, what are the attack, what are the risk which is happening nowadays in Calcutta, in India and all over the world. How many of you over here needs compliance to GDPR? Can I see some hands? Anybody over here, GDPR? How many of you heard about GDPR? Okay. So how many of you heard about GDPR? I want some reaction, I want it interactive. Right, very good. How much is the penalty for GDPR? I believe, last row. How much is the penalty? Nobody? 4% of the gross annual turnover or 20 million euro, whichever is higher. So if you are not compliant to GDPR, you have to shell out 20 million euro from your pocket. This is the first time what we see that some specific penalty amount has been part of the compliance, as part of the regulation, government regulation. How many of you come from a company who is handling intellectual property? Yes, last row. How many of you are using Gmail interface? Right. So some of the companies are now shifting to Gmail as the official email interface. How do you manage? How do you stop the employees, considering that 80% threats are internal threats? Okay, people are settling down. Hold on. How do you make sure that people who are using, you have given the Gmail interface, they are not uploading the intellectual property of the company into the Gmail? When we go for audit, because I go to hundreds of companies for audit, we see these are the challenges that these companies are facing. I believe I have come here to look forward to answer to all these problems from these guys. And I'm sure that a lot of the problems you will be throwing to them so they can give the answers. How many of you have heard about ransomware? So if you have not heard, then you are either sleeping or there is a serious awareness, IT security awareness in your company. How do you stop the ransomware? Because this has been affecting almost most of the companies in Calcutta, in India and all over the world. I can see people from manufacturing companies, people from power sector who are more interested in OT security. But overall, if we look into the police files, the real police files, not the Sony CID files, we see every time, every day, there are hundreds of cases which are getting filed at Lal Bazar and CID and Bhavani Bhavan. Now the problem is whenever we face a cyber crime, we run to the police and we expect that they will solve our problem. Now, I cannot expect the police department to solve catch a thief when I have myself kept the door open? Now you might ask me, how big should be the lock? If I put a lock on the door, does it mean that my house will not be robbed? There is always a chance my house will get robbed. But if we don't put the lock on the door, then the risk of my house getting robbed is much higher. Now, how big the lock you will put on the door depends on how much money you have within your house. The lock should not be bigger than the money. The cost of the lock should not be bigger than the money. So as an auditor, as an ethical hacker, and every day talking to the police department, because we interact every day, almost whenever there is a case, they also need technical support from people like us. Situation is worsening with the time. So it was a big interest for me personally to come and listen to this, Forcepoint, ki how they are solving all these issues. We are relying more and more on cloud. I believe that is a challenge, right? Brajesh, right? Right. We are putting data on cloud. We don't know where that data is. We have no idea where people are accessing it from. As and when the technology is improving, we are losing more and more control on it. So a lot of questions will come to you people. I believe you have all the answers. I am just here to set the tempo and do the warm up. Usually I saw a live demo, but I think that is not required. These people are already scared, that's why they are here. I would like to mention few things about NASSCOM SIG, because I am representing the SIG as the security special interest group. We have a security group for NASSCOM. We are doing a lot of work on behalf of NASSCOM. I must mention it since I am representing that part as a chairman, NASSCOM East. We are organizing CIO Connect almost every month, where we are inviting the top CIOs. I think nice thing that you people are, you are also doing a CIO Connect over here. So we are also trying to do that. We are trying to share the experience of one CIO with the other CIOs. You come with a lot of knowledge that I believe will add value to it. We are doing a skill connect because all of you need manpower, right? Skilled security manpower. So I was interacting with some people out here. I think we heard that some university has a BTEC on cyber security. So where are you, sir? You were here? I think he was there. So that manpower we are also tying up with from behalf of NASSCOM. We are coming up with monthly newsletters where we need expertise from you people. So Nirupamda is here. Mr. Nirupam Chaudhary. Oh, he's outside. Okay. So you can connect to us. Shomok is there, the one of the key pillars of our NASSCOM SIG. So we can share your ideas, your expertise with us. We will accumulate and we will share with everybody. We have a handbook on which you can find on the NASSCOM link, which actually gives you a lot of ideas about the latest risks, new risk and the new compliance. And I look forward to see what you have for us. I'll be there also asking a lot of questions. And I believe everybody over here who has come, they have their own problems which they are looking for a solution. That's why they have come over here. So thank you for coming over to Kolkata and sharing your knowledge and expertise. and maybe come up with some solution. And from NASCOM and from all over here in Calcutta, thank you very much. And I look forward to a big interaction from the crowd over here and throw some lot of technical questions to them, because they are also geeks, and we will get a lot of geeky answers from them. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sandeep. I'm sure with this short and sweet speech, you know, the stage is set in terms of what a vulnerable world that we are living in. You know, I'm sure you must have got it from some of the trends that Sandeep also mentioned, that, you know, cloud is becoming so widespread, but at the same time, it's you know, it's giving us this sense of insecurity that I'm allowing to store my very sensitive data on a third party system which I have no control over. How do I get that control back? I want my employees to roam everywhere because I want to expand my business. I also want to ensure that security doesn't become a business hindrance, right? So there are so many questions that we have, you know, inside us. And just to kind of summarize what Forcepoint has seen globally in terms of trends and how, as a thought leader in cybersecurity, we are here to solve those challenges by global organizations. I'd like to invite our technology consultant and a subject matter expert on cybersecurity, Mr. Brijesh Miglani, on stage to give you an overview of what Forcepoint is all about, what are the different solutions that we have to offer, and how do they address the challenges that we have you know, as enterprises. So with a big round of applause, please welcome Mr. Brijesh Miglani.
Thanks, Archil. So good evening, everybody. Can you just switch? Okay. Okay. So hi, this is Brijesh Miglani. I'm a senior sales engineer to Forcepoint, working on a Forcepoint products from the last close to 7-8 years now. So today we'll discuss more on human-centric security. So as Sir mentioned and Harshil mentioned, that the typical challenges that we are facing nowadays is what we're going to cover and how Forcepoint is giving a different solutions altogether to cover that. So to start with, currently, as we discussed, that our world looks different now. So what we see nowadays is that the things are not limited to only corporate network. So we also have the things coming out from the cloud, things where we are storing the data over the cloud, not only to our private cloud, but also to the public cloud, where the organizations are moving to G Suite, Office 365, accessing things over the box or other set of solutions. So it's very complex. It's not only limited to the parameter itself. And there are suppliers and vendors to whom you interact. They access your systems. They access it maybe over a VPN or over the remote applications. And they can access it from anywhere. So what we are seeing over a period of time is, whatever the data breaches happened over the period of time, whatever the attacks that happened over the period of time, the one thing which is very constant in security is the people. So typical attacks are changing from a normal virus to a ransomware to PETA virus and all that. But still the thing which is very constant is the people, because the people have access to those data and those informations which are getting hacked or getting leaked. So what Forcepoint is doing differently is to first understand the user intent. So if an organization is able to segregate that what is the typical behavior of my user, whether they are accessing internally and externally, then they will better able to provide the controls. And they can segregate a user into different categories. So there may be a users who are accidental users, who are not aware that what is intent of if sharing that data to a public site. So take an example. In most of the organizations, what we have seen with the risk assessment is that the people are sharing the data or uploading the data to a gmail.com. They are doing that because they want that they can access it offline within their home and work on that data. But they are not aware that if the data is a part of a gmail.com and if the Gmail IDs got hacked, they are not aware what can be used for that data. Same way, if the user is got hacked or there is a malware which is sitting in the user machine, and if that malware is doing a data exfiltration, that may be a compromised user. But still, it's an insider. And there are certain users which have a malicious intent. They are intentionally doing because maybe they are not getting a good appraisal score. They are not getting something within a company. So there is an intent behind anything, whether it will be intentional or unintentional. So what a data breach investigation reports of Verigen says that all of these behaviors on your network at this very moment is needs to be understood. So if you better understood that behavior, you will better able to provide the controls to it. And what it says that 81% of the hacking is related to the breaches which is related to compromised credential or stolen credentials. So the people are not aware that their credentials are stolen and they may be accessing the applications which they have access to, users which have a privileged access to, via different behaviors. Because we as organizations are not monitoring their behaviors currently, so it's difficult to segregate what is a normal behavior and what is a malicious behavior. People also do mistakes. So they are not aware that what is the intent of uploading a data to a Dropbox.com. What is the impact of uploading a password file to a GitHub repository? Okay, so they are not aware of the intent of it. Malware also plays a role where the things like ransomware and all are also contributes to more than 70% of data breaches. But from where the malware comes is typically either from a web layer or either from an email layer via phishing email. So, and at the last, people can also be malicious, and we need to just see the intent of it. So if you see this particular image, this is what is the challenge for our all security consultants nowadays. That security is never done. If I'll ask any one of you that are you fully secure now, you may say that, okay, I have applied a patch last day and I'm secure. But if the same question arises in the next week, you will say, I'm not sure. So this is the rolling ball which we are fighting on every day. Okay? And our fight is to wearing us down. So the point is that security is never done. It's always a regular process. So, anyone know what is a cyber fatigue? Anyone wants to try for that? What is a cyber fatigue? So, it's a problem, it's a situation where I think we all who are into security or into a cyber security are facing this issue. And we are into that cybersecurity fatigue, which says that cyber fatigue is the feeling of being tired, both physically and mentally, because of so much cybersecurity warnings. Every day, maybe organizations are using different alert systems, different solutions, which sends so much alerts that, and so much warning and incidents that the person has to understand whether he's safe or not. That's our mindset currently. So we are still not sure that after spending so much amount on the security, best of breed technologies, still as an organization, are we secure or not? Is that a common problem? Are you agree to it, or do you have a different mindset altogether? Because this we have to understand first before we say that we are going with A, B, C solution. And what is our role nowadays is more of a firefighter. We get to know that on Sunday there is an attack which has happened in US. The next day, Monday morning, complete India security team in each organization is on the toes to check whether that attack, whether they are getting the protection for that attack from all the security vendors or not. Okay, that's our current situation. And indefinitely, when we are playing a role of a firefighter, we sometimes burn our hands as well, right? So if we'll focus on more on a fire suppression techniques where we will not get a heat of that fire, we will not in that situation where we have to run, because maybe we better understand that these are the things, these are the suppression system that is required to avoid that fire or to minimize the impact of that fire. So many of you has invested into multiple logging systems, a SIM solutions or maybe a different logging system. Are those systems are giving you the specific alerts? What are specific indicators, as Harshil mentioned, which are predictive? Or still the security landscape that we are seeing or that is currently implemented is purely threat centric. So what do you say? Is it currently a threat centric that you are using, or human centric? So most of the solutions that currently are in place is purely on a threat centric. A virus came, the next day the release will be in place, because you are not aware that what will be the impact of it within your organizations. Okay. So today cybersecurity challenges, to just brief of it, you can add more to it, is my data is now stored everywhere. How many of you are already moved to a cloud solutions or mobility? Only 2-3. Those others are still on-premise, purely closed network, no cloud. So then how you are managing the expectation of your employee who wants anywhere access? He wants maybe to work from home, but still contribute to the organization. So cloud adaptability and mobility has increased over a period of time. And what we have seen is cloud applications has increased 11x after 2015. Okay, in each and every mobile that we are using, maybe we are not sure why we require that cloud app, but everyone is storing maybe not more than, maybe more than 30 plus applications in our mobile. And we are accessing those applications. Same is happening within your internet. So currently the user don't go and browse dropbox.com. They have a Dropbox application sitting on their machine where they can upload a data to Dropbox and it will be auto sync to a Dropbox server. They don't need to type dropbox.com for doing that. So adaptability of a cloud applications has increased over a period of time. And because it's increased over a period of time, and there is also a cost effective offerings that are available from Microsoft Office 365, Gmail, G Suite,
where the people are moving from on-premise exchange to a cloud over a G Suite or Office 365. And when you are over Office 365 G Suite, you are not only using Exchange, you are also using OneDrive, Google Drive, which are the data repositories where you will, yeah, SharePoint, where you store your data. So once the data is a part of that repository, you are not sure who is accessing my data, whether the data is downloaded over a period of time or not. So that's the one of the cybersecurity challenge that we are seeing across all the industry. And to be very frank, 1 year back when we discussed the same with some government organizations, we get to know that they are not very open for cloud. They still want to restrict them to an on-premise. But in this year, we have also seen government people who are also moving to Office 365. Banking customers who are moving to Office 365. Because that's the way forward. Now the other challenge that we are seeing is there are too many solutions. Because on an endpoint, we start with an antivirus, we have an HTTPS, we have an NTAPT, we have data security, we have maybe other set of encryption solutions, multiple solutions we have, but all the solutions, they don't interact. So do you have a visibility that if a user is outside the organization and accessing a site which is a malicious site, and during that malicious site access, there is a data which is uploading during that same time? Do you get that visibility currently from a different set of solutions? No. Because web security solutions is giving their own logs. DLP solution is giving their own logs. They don't interact. So they will not able to segregate whether that data exfiltration is happening because of a user intention or because of a malware intention. So because we are not focusing to it, we are not able to understand, we are not going into that to understand whether it's a actual data theft or a data leak. And I hope you understand what is the difference between a data leak and a data theft, which is malware driven. Other challenges that we have seen over a period of time, starting with 4 or 5 years back, everyone concerned, there is a compliance that you have to store each and every log from all your security device. So there is a rush in the market for the SIM vendors, and everyone has taken a SIM and forwarded all the logs from those security device to a SIM and says now we are compliant. But are we seeing those logs proactively? What those logs are giving back to us? Okay, so that's where there are too much alerts that are not giving a critical signal. So the organizations don't have a single dashboard where it says, okay, these are my top 20 or 30 people, because anyhow, it's an entity. That entity can be a machine, that entity can be a server, and that entity can be a person. Okay. So the dashboard is not giving me a visibility that what are my top 10 or 20 risky users or risky systems from where I have to focus on. And then by the time we figure out that there is a breach happened, it takes a minimum 46 days to understand that the organization got breached. And still in India, privacy laws are not that stringent that the company will come to news and say, okay, I got breached. So as sir mentioned, GDPR says that if you got breached, you have to intimate within 72 hours. Okay, definitely there will be another impact to it, but the intention is how we can cover those cybersecurity challenges.
So what we are doing is, as we acquired multiple solutions over a period of time, starting from the solutions which are coming from WebSense, solutions which are coming from Raytheon Cybersecurity Division, acquisitions that we have done over a period of time. So we have created an approach where all our solutions fit into. So traditional approach, and I think most of the you will agree to it, is it's easy to classify what is good, what is bad. And the current parameter that we take for good is, Brijesh is working in WebSense from 8 years. He's a good employee. So a company CISO, or maybe a company IT head, or maybe other person in HR, finance and all, they are working on with organization from the last 10 years. So that identity is, he is good. Allow him. So we don't see that if I'm allowing that user, there may be a case where this particular user is hacked. And the access given to that user will be compromised. So that's our definition of being a good. And being a bad is, we know that, okay, these are the viruses, these are the files, these are the URL or categories which are bad, just block them. So what is good is allowed, what is bad is needs to be blocked, purely on a static approach. And if we get to know, okay, this is also harmful, we'll block that. But the major issue lying within this thing, bell curve, which is hard to classify. So how we'll identify that what is good and bad within this bell curve? So what we say is, we will help you in providing the context to this particular bell curve. And how you can build that is by building a context along with your security incidents. So when I say context, it will be intention why that security incident has happened. And it will be risk adaptive. So we will not go into a static paradigm. It will be risk adaptive. If we are seeing a behavior of a user risky with the normal baseline that he do on a daily basis, will increase the risk of that user. And we always revisit it. So take an example. Brijesh normally is an IT administrator, network administrator. Normally access the VPN over the home office and do certain activities. Over the period of time, we have not seen that he's downloading anything when he connects over a VPN. Now, after 30 days or 40 days, what we have seen is, as when he's connecting, he's trying to access certain applications where he's an administrator, and he's trying to download a data during that time. So if we are not monitoring the behavior of Brijesh as an administrator, we will not able to see this change where his behavior got changed. And then definitely we have things coming from a solutions like metadata informations, forensics, evidences to take a decision whether he's a malicious user or compromised user or accidental user. Okay. So what we're going to discuss on the solution is how to protect this with a human-centric approach. So focus on a true constant thing, as I mentioned, is people and data. So understanding the intersection of a people and the data. So if we know
to be very simple, that these are my critical users. So in a manufacturing, the critical department may be R&D department, and the critical data may be an intellectual property that they build. In a software, our developers can be a critical BU or a persons, and the IP that they develop is their critical data. So till the time we understand both of these parameters well, over a period of time, we will have a better human-centric security in place. Because at the end, wherever they interact is the reason for their getting exploited, whether it's by malware, whether it's by intention. So we'll discuss on this people and data interactions in the further slides. So as a message from a first point, what we do in a human-centric security is we understand the rhythm of your people. So whatever the solution that we provide, we provide a visibility and understanding what your users are doing and where your data is flowing. So take an example, as sir mentioned, that you are storing a critical data in SharePoint or OneDrive. And take an example, like GDPR says that any EU-based PII information, and it's also applicable to BFSI, if a PII information is there, first you have to identify that PII information, where that PII information is lying. So it may be lying in local repositories, like file servers, like structured repositories, like databases, SAP applications, and it can also lie nowadays in applications like SharePoint, OneDrive and all, because that are also data repositories. So we'll help you in identifying, discovering that the PII information is lying on this SharePoint or on this OneDrive, and it's externally shared, because these are the mediums where we share the data. So that's where we help you in flowing of data. So we provide a visibility, we provide a policy framework to deliver that. Enforcement, where we'll say we need to enforce it. So where we need to enforce it and then provide a compliance view to it. So this is the human system solutions that we have. So as an organization can start from any of the solution and can interact and build a complete portfolio. So you can maybe a customer starting with Forcepoint web security, providing a security over a web, moving to a data security, and then moving to a risk adaptive security. You may be starting from the use case where you want to protect and have a visibility of your cloud applications. And when I say cloud application, it can be a public applications like Office 365, G Suite, and it can be your private application which you have exposed to outside. So if a private application also have the risk for data getting downloaded to an unmanaged machine, CASB can also provide that controls to it. So not only we only provide a security, we also provide a analytics within our product. And this analytics also leads to an orchestration, where on a real-time risk factor, we can take an action to block that user, or to block the maybe AD access of that user with the orchestration. So just talking about in brief the solution, so WebSense is known for its data security, web security solutions. So we are into market leaders from last 9-10 years in DLP. Forcepoint Insider Threat, which is a typical solution designed for the US federal also provide you an insider threat view where you can monitor the intent of the user by a desktop video replay. So if there is any data movement happening internally, so DLP comes into picture when the data is moving out of parameter via endpoint, via web, via email, or via FTP, SFTP and all. But if there is a critical data movement internally, okay, so insider threat also takes care of it. Then we have a solution which is a user entity behavior analytics. Those of you if seen the demo that is given by Tuhin outside, he was also showing that how a UEBA, which we also say is the brain of our human point system, contributes to different risk modeling that we do. Based on that different risk modeling, we segregate that whether that behavior, whether that exchange of information is compromised or a normal behavior. So how Forcepoint delivers that? So I'll just take a pause, and if anyone have any query or thing, or should we are good to go? Any queries? Okay. So how Forcepoint delivers it? So this is a current mission that we want to protect an important data wherever it resides. So whether it resides on-premise, whether it's over a cloud, whether it's over a mobile, any set of thing is without frustrating a user. So take an example, a user needs to take an important presentation to their client. Now as soon as he is trying to copy that presentation to the USB, he gets the alert that his USB is blocked. Definitely that user is frustrated. And then there may be internal policies or internal approvals that are required to take that access. Overwhelming administrators. Administrators say that I have too many dashboards, too many management consoles to follow. It's very difficult for me to understand out of these 5,000 alerts, which alerts I have to look first. And then, if there are false positives, we are mistaking a normal user as a hacker, or a normal user as a malicious user. Okay. So today's protection is traditional UEBA do a forensics analysis, but they lack the data visibility. So they can give you a good behavior, says that okay, we are seeing a behavior, number of connections opening on IPS, firewall and all. And at the same time, we are seeing some registry changes over the endpoint. This may be a case of malicious user. But if we'll say that, okay, what is the data impact to it? Whether that exfiltration is also happening along with the data or not, the UEBA don't have a visibility to it. So they are dependent on either data security solutions to provide that. And a traditional DLPs purely work on a policies, too rigid to be effective. And most of the people start a DLP project saying that, okay, maybe in the next 2 months or 3 months, we'll put a DLP in a blocking state and we will start getting an ROI from a DLP solution. But it takes multiple years to move into that blocking because we are not sure that the policies which are in place will able to cover those use cases. So we, as a solution providers, need to cut through the noise for those alerts and provide you a proactive and a predictive signals to start with. So I will first want to cover a brain of it, because our all solutions interact with this brain component which provides them a visibility in terms of which is the next action I have to perform. And in a human-centric view, we provide a visibility on the communication channels. So we as a human use certain communication channels. That communications channel will be either an email, either a chat, either voice transcripts. So it will tell, so if we analyze that, it will tell how that user is feeling, with whom he is interacting. So if you want, so we are getting certain use cases where the organizations are coming and say, okay, I want that these are my critical users to check to whom they are interacting or to whom they are chatting over that IM. So that's what provides me a communication view to it. System view, the logs which are coming from endpoints, SIM and all, provide me how they are behaving digitally. So what is the behaviors for those users? What sites they go, what system they access, what are the typical things that they download? That is what it gets from a system. Now we miss most of the things within our security solution that is coming from an HR, which is say, what is their motivation? Why they are doing that? So the current solution or a thing that most of the organization follows, they'll go back to the same user and say, why you are doing that? Without taking into account, without considering that there is a entity which can contribute from a data which is coming from an HR. So some of the people do that maybe because of a performance review. Some of the people do that because maybe they have a more privileged access. And then the physical systems. So physical systems, how they behave physically. How many times they access data center? At what time they access data center? That what is their normal behavior? So all these feed into the Forcepoint UEBA to provide a view that whether those users' activities are related to a compromised insider or a malicious insider. So that will help you in early signs to it. Now, most of the UEBA are limited to networks. They only provide you a visibility for the logs which are coming from network. It will be IPS, firewall, anything which is going to SIM. They get those into a UEBA. But they also lack that what is happening at the same time on the endpoint. So if I am seeing on a same time on an endpoint, so Forcepoint insider threat provide different data collectors during the same timestamp. So if we are seeing that during the time when we are saying that a user is a malicious user, we are also seeing the logs coming out from an insider threat solution, providing a visibility that this particular registry got changes during that time. And just few minutes before, there was a exe or a file which got downloaded to his machine. And why it has happened? Because he has accessed a URL, which is the information coming from a web security. So all these things, you currently also feed it to a SIM solution. But for getting that intelligence, you have to write a correlation rule. The better you write a correlation rule, you will get a better result. But a UEBA provides you a visibility in terms of risk modeling, which says whether that user is a compromised user, negative behavior, whether it's a malicious behavior. So all that behavior patterns you will get with all that log analysis. And this particular solution can also, what happened? There is a power off. So any question? So is all good going in the organization? All are secured? No one has any challenges or use cases which they want to discuss? Because it's an open forum. We can have an interaction, we can share it across if someone is facing some challenges which can be addressed. So what type of user you will? Yep. Yep.
On the other hand, user is using the laptop or phone to access something from the company's website or company's mail and SMS.
Okay. Yeah. So yeah. So when we say we'll cover the user irrespective of the location from his login. So take an example that a user who is logging from his office machine in the office will have certain access. Same time we provide that if the user is roaming, if the user is outside, still you can have those security access control within the endpoint where the user is roaming. So those controls go along with the laptop. So if he's accessing a laptop or a data during roaming or during mobility, still we will able to have a visibility to it. Okay. And we will have a protection to it. So definitely the policies and the things will be bind to a user ID. So in that case, if a Brijesh is a user, whether he is accessing from internal or external, he will get that same set of policies. But we can have a relaxation where if we want, okay, Brijesh is a user who is using a laptop, but when he is going out, he wants to have some relaxed access, we can provide that as well.
So